Considering the artificial being nature of Terminators, we'd expect their actions to be rigidly confined to their programmed missions, but it's not the case. In the first Terminator movie, there was that moment where Arnie smoothed his hair in the mirror, as if he has pride. And after having his efforts to kill Sarah thwarted, he no longer bothers trying to conceal his weapons, as if he's so angry he's now decided to hell with social appearances. His choice of words toward the janitor suggests the same angry hostility.
Fuck you, asshole.
And when he killed Sarah's mother, how much of it was just mission efficiency, and how much was an act of revenge? The ego thing is present again in Terminator 2. He wore shades in the first movie to cover a damaged eye, but in the second film he wears them just to look cool. And the carrying of a shotgun and a box of flowers, hey, does that imply a sense of love for the boy he's going to protect? Sure, these ideas don't apply in terms of surface narrative, but bear with me because they do seem to strongly apply to the T-1000 as well. Just as Arnie adopted a cool biker outlaw image, the T-1000 seems attracted to a biker image of his own.
You okay?
Fine.
Say, that's a nice bike.
There was no need to have the character say this because it implies pride and ego, two things a computer definitely shouldn't have. And when he takes on the biker appearance, he adopts a pair of shades as part of the image, even though the human cop on the bike wasn't wearing any. So both Terminators want to look cool. There are implications that he enjoys killing too. The first murder is off-screen and quick because we're not supposed to know yet that he's the bad guy. But when he kills the stepdad with a brutal blade through the throat, not a finger through the eye, it's like he's telling the guy to shut the fuck up. Like he's annoyed with him. And then he stares at the corpse as if he's still annoyed. Then we get the killing of the hospital guard. He could have drove a finger through the back of this guy's skull, but lets the guy turn and see him before slowly raising his hand and delivering the finger jab through the eye socket. He took a risk here of the guard calling out in shock, so it seems that he wanted to look this guy in the face as he was killing him. Note the prolonged eye contact. Actually, he probably could have gotten into this building by snaking his way through a ventilation shaft or just trickling along the corridor floors as a long sliver of liquid that wouldn't be noticed. His choice to kill the family dog is questionable too. He could have spotted the name on the collar from a distance, but like with the husband, the dog has annoyed him by giving his presence away during the phone call, so it's execution time. Kids in the shopping mall are shoved aside but not killed so as to avoid offending the audience. His actions are just enough to convey his disregard for kids, which is important considering that a kid is his assassination target. But this poor fella is executed when a shove aside would have sufficed like it did in the shopping mall.
Damn! You are right! Oh!
It seems that after the helicopter crash, the T-1000 is getting more and more frustrated. And then there's the moment when he kills Arnie, or almost does. He takes his time doing this, even letting Arnie crawl for the last few moments of false hope, not that a robot should have feelings of hope, before delivering one seemingly torturous blow, even though neither of them are supposed to feel pain, and then the big kill. This all goes against his programmed mission. John Connor is currently getting away and could be leaving the factory altogether, possibly never to be tracked down again. And yet, the T-1000 is savouring the destruction of Arnie's Terminator. There's hate and revenge in his actions. Same again when he pins Sarah through the shoulder. He tells her to call out to John.
Call to John. I know this hurts. Call John.
But we already know that he can imitate the voices of others. He did it with the foster mother, so why doesn't he do it now? Again, going against programming, he seems more interested in torturing the companions of his primary target and making them wallow in their final moments of lost hope. I mean, he didn't even pick up the rocket launcher after killing Arnie. In every other battle, he makes use of weapons, but now it seems his aim is to kill all of his enemies with his stabbing implement bare hands, just for the satisfaction of it. It is possible that some of these facets are just bad scripting. It's common in action movies to have the bad guys make very stupid decisions when getting close to killing the good guys. It gives those good guys enough wriggle room to make a last-second escape, but it often just comes off as corny and unconvincing. But I think a lot of what we see with the T-1000 is an intentional theme of him being like a cat who likes to toy with the captured mouse before killing it. This is present early on in the film. Seeing John Connor, he walks swiftly after him, and he only bursts into a rapid run once John is on a motorbike. Time and time again, he alters the pace of his pursuit so that his target is just about able to desperately continue with the chase. He doesn't smash through the elevator roof until the doors are open and his targets escape, but he could have just slithered through the holes he'd made. At the end of the film, his damaged motor skills give some justification to him walking but not running in pursuit of his injured opponents, and yet, here, he casually lets Sarah fumble to reload the shotgun before pinning her. You may think I'm nitpicking, but there are more implications that the T-1000 has human motives lurking under his programming facade. For one thing, he does seem to have a visual identity. He keeps reverting back to the Robert Patrick look, even though it isn't necessary for his mission. He kills the first cop, but instead of imitating him completely, he just imitates his clothes and keeps his original head and overall physique. He gets a cop bike, presumably killing the cop who he took it off, but again, doesn't adopt the cop's facial appearance, he keeps his own. And throughout the movie, not only does he keep reverting back to the same facial and physical appearance, an appearance that his target enemy has already seen and will thus recognise, but he keeps adopting the uniform of a cop. It's like he finds the cop appearance appealing, an authority figure whose job is to pursue targets. So when exposed as a fake double of Sarah, he morphs back into the cop appearance, but there was no practical reason to do this. Yes, the T-1000 has an identity that is largely of his own choosing. Think about how much more difficult an enemy he would be if he even did basic things like changing his hairstyle, skin colour, height, build, outfits, and so on. It would vastly improve his stealth abilities. He even has specific emotional expressions from time to time. He frowns in confusion at the mannequin. He opens his mouth in shock when his arm freezes and breaks off. When shot with the rocket launcher, he has a snap look of terror before exploding from within. And he thrashes in terror and possibly physical pain as he melts. A robot should not have the will to live. The menacing stare he gives with the slightly bowed head, it conveys personal intent to his actions. Unfortunately, it's become one massive fucking cliche these days, especially in superhero movies. And even supposedly more mature movies and TV shows like Breaking Bad feature it excessively, even on their DVD box artwork. It's a cliche that I hate in modern movies, and actually it's even extended into video games now as well. It's across the board. Very annoying. But anyway, that's a rant for another day. By the way, when the T-1000 is recovering from the freezing liquid nitrogen and he has that meditative eyes closed moment, he even takes his only noticeable breath in the whole movie, as if preparing for what he considers to be the final lap of the chase. But, as a machine, he shouldn't need to breathe at all. And how could we not perceive his finger wag warning to Sarah as an emotionally motivated gesture of competitive ego? Or his cocky response early in the movie, where he learns that he has an opponent Terminator to contend with.
There was a guy here this morning looking for him too.
Yeah, a big guy on a bike. Has that got something to do with this?
No. I wouldn't worry about him.
Confidence. Yes, beneath the technological narrative framing of the T-1000 lies the mind of a human.